Hallelujah and blessings in Jesus, friends. Welcome back to Hayakadosh Ministries, where holiness is a way of life. Jesus is truly King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and the Holy Bible is our only standard and authority for truth. And together God's people say with hearts of praise, hallelujah. Well, friends, today is December the 28th in the year of our Lord, 2017. And this is One a Day for the Soul. Now we are continuing our journey through the story of the Bible, and today we find ourselves in chapter 18. Now chapter 18 is split into two parts. The first part is going to be the story of three visitors. Now one of these visitors is the Lord himself, the Almighty. The other two is simply speculative. And so chapter 18 begins by saying, "The Lord appeared unto him, unto Abraham, in the plains of Mamre. And he sat in the tent door in the heat of the day. And when he lifted up his eyes and looked, lo, he saw three men that stood by him. And when he saw them, he ran to meet them from the tent door and bowed himself toward the ground. And he said, My Lord, if now I have found favor in thy sight, pass not away, I pray thee, from thy servant. Let a little water, I pray you, be fetched, and wash your feet, and rest yourselves under the tree." Now this was customary to do to any visitor that would come to your home. And so Abraham continues in verse 5, he says, "I will fetch a morsel of bread, comfort ye your hearts. After that you shall pass on. For therefore are you come to your servant." And they said, "So do as thou hast said." And so after preparing a meal for them and dining together, the Lord reconfirms what he has already told Abraham and Sarah, that they are going to have a child. Now when Sarah overhears this, she laughs because she's an old woman. She's well beyond her years of producing children. And so the Lord says to Abraham in verse 13, "Why did Sarah laugh? Is anything too hard for the Lord?" And in verse 15, Sarah denies saying, "I did not laugh," because she was afraid. Well, it is at this point in the story, in the chapter, that we're going to see the split. And so verse 16 says, "The men rose up from thence, they looked toward Sodom, and Abraham went with them to bring them on the way. Now the Lord said, Shall I hide from Abraham what I'm about to do? For surely Abraham will be a great and mighty nation, and all the nations of the earth will be blessed in him. I know him. I know that he will raise up and teach his children properly. They shall keep the way of the Lord to do justice and judgment." And so the Lord says in verse 20, "Because the cry of Sodom and Gomorrah is great, and because their sin is very grievous, I will go down now, and I will see whether they have done altogether according to the cry of it, which is come unto me, and if not, I will know." And so the men turned their faces from thence and went towards Sodom. But Abraham stood yet before the Lord. Now remember, when Abraham and his nephew Lot grew too large to live among each other, they went their different ways. And we're told Abraham remained in the plain, but Lot pitched his tents towards Sodom, eventually moving into Sodom. And so Abraham, realizing that all of Sodom and Gomorrah is not unrighteous, he begins to intercede on their behalf. And so he says in verse 23, "Will you destroy the righteous with the wicked? If there be 50, will you destroy them?" And the Lord says, "If there are 50, I will not." Abraham says in verse 28, "If there be 45, will you destroy it?" And the Lord says, "I will not." In verse 29, he says, "If there be 40, will you destroy it?" And the Lord says, "I will not." In verse 30, he says, "If there be 30 righteous that be found within the city, will you destroy it?" And the Lord says, "I will not." Verse 31, Abraham says, "If there are 20 that are found, will you destroy it?" And the Lord again says, "I will not." And Abraham says in verse 32, "Oh, let not the Lord be angry, and I will speak yet but once more. If only 10 are found therein, would you destroy it?" And the Lord said, "I will not." However, as we move into verse 19, we see the Lord is about to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. And so obviously not even 10 righteous are found within, including Lot and his family. And so verse 1 begins by saying, there came two angels to Sodom at evening, and Lot sat in the gate of Sodom. Lot, seeing them, rose up to meet them, and he bowed himself with his face toward the ground. And what follows in the continuing verses is going to be the story of the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah, the salvation of Lot and temporarily of his wife, and then her flagrant disobedience in doing precisely what the Lord commanded her not to do. And in our next time together, that's what we'll address. But I want to go back to verse 20 of chapter 18, where the Lord says, because of the cry of Sodom and Gomorrah, because it is great and their sin is very grievous, I will now go down and see whether this thing is true. And so let me ask you at this point, what is the sin of Sodom and Gomorrah? Well, if you're like most people, you would say homosexuality. And this would include, of course, lesbianism and other perverted sex acts. But what we must understand is that is the final result of the sin of Sodom and Gomorrah. Just as we are told in Romans chapter 1, that as sin begins in the heart of man, and they seek to follow the lust of their own hearts, it begins very deceptively and very subtly. But as we as human creatures give ourselves to our own way and we deny God's way, it opens the door to a progression of sin. And ultimately, there comes a point where God withdraws his hand. He lets men loose upon themselves, and the final result leads to perverted sexual acts that God never intended. And it's important that we understand this because there are steps of progression that lead to greater forms of sin. And a couple of examples of that would be, for instance, that of a serial killer. As studies have been done, no one woke up and began killing other people. It started as a childhood fantasy, maybe simply fantasizing about killing other living creatures, drawing pictures of these things, writing detailed stories about these acts, then maybe killing something like frogs or lizards or snakes or cats or dogs, until their appetite grew so strong, their lust for murder grew so deep that they eventually turned to the ultimate act of murder, which would be another human life. The same with a drug addict who is at this point in his life shooting drugs. Well, when he first began with the curiosity of drugs, he didn't begin by shooting up. He might have began by smoking marijuana, drinking beer, popping a few pills, but the hunger grew, the appetite deepened, until eventually he was sticking needles in his arms. And we know the same to be true about Sodom and Gomorrah when the Lord says again in verse 20, I see that their sin is very grievous. Well, if we turn to Ezekiel chapter 16 and verse 49, we're going to learn what the sin of Sodom and Gomorrah actually was. Ezekiel says, behold, this was the iniquity, this was the sin of thy sister Sodom. Now notice what it is. Pride, thinking too highly of themselves, thinking themselves above the need of God in their lives. Fullness of bread, having everything that they wanted, living in a state of prosperity as opposed to a state of need where they depended upon the hand of God. Abundance of idleness. You've heard the old saying, idle hands are a devil's playground. Well, this was another form of sin that Sodom and Gomorrah was guilty of. They had too much empty time on their hands. They weren't busy working, and this left them with only time to play, where they filled their days with drunkenness and orgies and the like. And they were so preoccupied with themselves, the verse ends by saying, neither did she strengthen the hand of the poor and needy. They were selfish and self-centered and only focused upon pleasuring themselves as opposed to meeting the needs of the poor and needy. They were haughty. They were high-minded. They thought much too highly of themselves. And these being the beginning stages of their ultimate sin, homosexuality, lesbianism, and other forms of perverted sex, these led them, in verse 50, to be an abomination before God. And so therefore, they must meet the judgment of God. Now this story is crucially important for us as the people of God, because it shows us that the danger is in the little things. And so we don't give them as much attention. But what this story reveals to us is that we need to give them all of our attention. Every form of pride is evil in the Lord's eyes. Every act of self-righteousness, every white lie, every feeling of envy, and every time that we only indulge ourselves rather than look upon the needs of others and meet those needs, these are all an abomination before God. And yet so many of us pat ourselves on the back that we're not rapists, that we're not murderers, that we're not drug addicts, that we're not alcoholics, that we're not adulterers. We go to church, we read our Bibles, we pray. And yet if we were to be truly honest with ourselves, with absolute transparency, examine our hearts for every form of pride, envy, jealousy, self-righteousness, self-seeking, self-gratification, laziness, idleness, gluttony, self-promotion, dissension, being over-argumentative, sowing discord, prejudice, and on the list can go. If we, with absolute transparency, examine our hearts, we are going to, maybe even to our own surprise, find that these things lie within our hearts. And if we don't crush them in their infancy, when they are small things, friends, their appetite is outside of our control. They will demand to be fed. And this will eventually lead to where they become so large within us that they now become our masters. And that's why Proverbs chapter 6 tells us that there are six things that God hates. And the seventh one is an absolute abomination unto him. God hates a proud look. God hates a deceptive tongue or a lying tongue. God hates hands that shed innocent blood. God hates a heart that devises wicked imaginations. Notice it doesn't say God hates someone who commits great acts of evil. It simply says he hates a heart that devises wicked imaginations, that daydreams, allows their minds to wander and fantasize about things that are wicked unto the Lord. And this is why lust after another person of the opposite sex, or maybe even after the same sex, this is why they are so abominable before God, because they are wicked imaginations. God hates feet that are swift in running to mischief and are always looking for trouble. God hates a false witness that speaks lies, or what we would call a gossip. Those are the six things that God hates. But the seventh thing, the one that he absolutely abhors, is one who sows discord among the brethren. And this again would be a gossip, but deeper than a simple gossip. This is one who spreads their lies simply to destroy the character of another and cause confusion. And so, friends, let us end today by looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 5, where we are told to examine ourselves with open transparency, whether to see you are in the faith or not. Prove your own selves, and anything you find within yourself that does not meet the standard of God, friends, take it before him with fear and trembling, realizing that even as simple as it may be in your mind, it could be the thing that causes your destruction. And so approach the holy God with reverence and fear, with fear and trembling. And don't stop asking until he has removed that thing from you, so that you can stand before him with a clear conscience and a clear mind, knowing that, as Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 11, that if you do not take these things to the Lord, Satan should get an advantage of you. And you are not ignorant of his devices. You are not ignorant of the way that he works. You know that he does not appear as a wolf, but as a wolf in sheep's clothing. He doesn't appear in all his darkness, but as an angel of light. And so let not your focus be upon the larger sins, where you find yourself congratulating yourself for not committing such acts, but focus upon the simplest of these things, friends. And be sure, absolutely sure, that you stand clean before the Lord, having through his power rid yourself of such things. Well, I love you, friends. I'm so grateful again that you're with us this morning. I pray that the Word of God is speaking to you and that it is changing you and conforming you into the man and woman of God that he has so created you to be. Now, as he wills, and until next time, I truly love you, and I'll see you on the next video.